Hey, welcome back. So this is our talk two of today's meetup, and it will be
All right, let me know if my screen's visible whenever. Hello.
I can see it. So
All right.
others, can you
All
thumbs
right, sir.
up if screen is visible? Cool. Yeah. So Varun.
Cool. Hey, good morning, everyone. Hope everyone's doing well. So I'm Varun, and I'll be talking about a pretty interesting design pattern in JavaScript called revealing module pattern. If you've been working with JavaScript for some time, chances are that you have used it or you've heard about it. You might have used it in some form or other if you're like building some sort of business logic on top of your application layer. And we'll be talking more about what it basically means. So, let's set a bit of preface around this talk. What and how we want to modularize an object, how we want to modularize an logic on your web app, and what are the patterns of doing that, right? And we'll be going through some of the example and also talking about how to do it with some of the quirks in JavaScript. And obviously, we'll take questions at the end, right? And this is going to be a pretty short presentation. There's not much really to it. It's a pretty simple concept. Please feel free to ask questions in between. As you can see, I guess I'm not on the EME tab. So, Petro, please feel free to interrupt and ask questions if there are any. So, a bit about me. A bit about me. Hey, this is me. I am a software engineer at Gophers. I've been working professionally since around a bit over 3.5 years. Out of that, my last 1 year was at Gophers. I am in a team which is kind of solving supply engineering problems. And that's a pretty complex sort of problem if you kind of want to scale that to Pan India. So I do not actually associate myself with the web with the UI development per se. I am more associated with in terms of JavaScript, and most of my work has been in JavaScript. And for that purpose, I am a generalist software engineer. What that means, I worked in across the stack in Python, Django, a bit of databases, Postgres, ELK, Mongo, and Infra, RabbitMQ, Kubernetes, and stuff. So I do not actually know what's the latest trend of React as when I was giving this their talk. I was just looking at how the React Spring works internally, and it's pretty amazing to see that they are internally using a queue to animate their the animation to anim they basically animate their animation, right? So yeah, I was just going through this thing, and yeah, this is what I find interesting. So I write at varundi.me. That's my personal website, and you can find a bit more information over there. SDQuote is my Twitter handle. Please feel free to tweet me on this thing. And I read fiction a lot. My latest read was Ready Player One, and it's a pretty good read. You'll find all my books over at goodreads.com. Other than that, I follow football with a passion. Like, I really love football and food, of course. Right. Okay. So I guess let's get to it. Let's start with this with a problem statement, right? Assume let's say you have a company which basically, or you have an app rather, right? which basically shows a, let's say, a static website which lists down all the cars, right, with their make and models and color, and their like colors that they are available in and stuff. And you see, hey, the popularity among this app is kind of declining. So what you do, you kind of, you sort of pivot, right? And what you do now is sort of make a Facebook around this thing where people can, like, you know, create their own car. So it's a concept car of a sort, and, you know, people can post it on your social networking website. And now others can comment, others can like, others can share and stuff, whatever. So that's the new feature that you're building, that's the direction your app would be heading towards. And now this entire thing, as you can see, is a bit complex than what it was initially. And what you now need is a sort of application on which people can, you know, create their own car and then save it and then share it and stuff. So let's take the, let's split in two halves. Let's back and front end. The first entry point of this problem statement is, like, you now, the user will be able to build a car on demand, right? The very first version of this. Okay, so by the way, now I'm like basically scoping the entire problem in sort of a deliverable, right? So now what I want to do is, now I want to basically build a car with any make and model and any color of the choosing, and I'll be able to, like, you know, change the color of my car and maybe later on add additional features to it. So that's the first entry point of it. Let's say you have a React app. You say, hey, you click a button, new car, that gives you a sort of widget, right? You try to change the car of the color, you change some additional, you add some modifications to it, right? And then you save it. And think about it, right? Multiple users doing the same operation on this thing. So you now sort of need a module you want a module that helps you build a car, and right, and the front end basically talks to this module via APIs and stuff, right? So tomorrow, let's say if you're migrating from React to a new super cool front end library, you can easily migrate to that because now you have exposed your module through APIs, so that will just stay intact, right? So let's dig into the details a bit deeper. You want to build cars, as many cars as possible, with this module of different make and model and possibly colors as well, right? So if you see through it, it is sort of a factory pattern, right? That you are able to now, you should be able to, you know, build dynamically build objects out of a module of different sorts, right? And that's a factory, pattern. Now, the factory pattern, along with like any creational pattern for that purpose, serves very well for a typed language, or rather an object-oriented paradigm for a language like Java, for example, where it's easy to, you know, construct objects and, you know, have it in a well-scoped format. But JavaScript being entirely an object, so everything is an object in JavaScript, right? Your number is an object, your string is an object, your function is an object, everything an object. And also, since there are no access modifiers out of the box in JavaScript, it's a bit tricky to do that, right? So let me show you what I mean by that. So let's say if I have a string called foo, right? You would very well argue that it's a string, it's not of type object, right? But what if I do this? Foo.proto, right? So it gives me a proto which is of type string. So what this means is, string is a constructor. That's a string, not a string, right? And let's say bar, right? So what it basically does, it gives me a constructor out of string function. So if I do bar dot proto, is the same, right? So these are the these are the APIs of the string that you know would be there in the MDN docs or wherever, right? Similarly here, I can directly go into the prototype. So prototype, yeah. I can directly go into the function signature and then check its prototype, and this is what I get, right? So and then let if I go another level up, dot proto. Oh man, proto. It gives me an object. Object prototype. So same thing. If I do prototype, it gives me the same result, right? And that means that if I do this, it will give me not equals to
equals. Varun, can you increase a font a little bit?
Right. Sorry. Yep. Right. So both of these refer to the same object prototype, the object constructor prototype, that is. And that is what I mean when I say like everything in JavaScript is derived out of an object. Is the text of the slide visible?
Yes, it is. Thumbs up.
All right, cool. Good. Yeah, and yeah, the other thing that there is no access modifier, as in there is no private public interface construct, out of the box construct in JavaScript, right? So that makes it a bit harder to form this sort of modularized APIs in JavaScript. But we can very well achieve that as with anything. This JavaScript works right around the whole language, and we'll use them to do that. And one of them is called closures, right? And we have a pattern in JavaScript called iffy pattern. Iffy basically means immediately invoked function expression. That is IIFE, immediately invoked function expression. What this means is I have a function that is just defined. So let's start from here. I have a function which is basically calls foo and console logs just the foo. Now, if I wrap it around the parentheses on line 1 and 4, and then just how we call a function, right? We just call it with a open close parenthesis. And if I do that, it now becomes a function expression which will get immediately invoked. So if I do this, if I do this, you can very well see that I have not defined something like, const function equals to function signature and then calling that function. I'll just define it here and then put up an open close parenthesis, and it gets immediately invoked. Like you can very well try this out in your consoles and stuff, and this will work. So this is one of the pattern in JavaScript called iffy pattern. And you can see as well with closures, if you add anything in the function declaration, they have the lexical scoping, as in you can access anything inside that scope and not outside it. So you can access foo inside this function scope and not outside it, right? So if you try to access foo in the window or in the document construct here, it will say that hey, foo is not defined. What are you asking for? And we'll use this iffy pattern along with so iffy pattern kind of implicitly says that you would be kind of using a closure in it. So we'll be using iffy pattern to define our module, right? So let's get back to our problem statement that we want to have a module called car or something, a car module, which will basically give me an API to, get the make model of the car and color and stuff, right? So a very simple pattern for that, a really simple pattern of that is called module pattern. So what it says is I still will have a named iffy, which is this car module. And in my return, what I'll do is I'll return an object literal, right? In which I can have the function calls, which will call my private members, which is basically done through closure. So what this means is I have a function declaration here, right? And I'm calling with the variables Toyota and Corolla. This is again an immediately invoked function expression. So Toyota and Corolla go to make and model, right? And I have a variable here called color white, right? And what I'm returning from this is basically an object with the function called getMake, getModel, getColor, and setColor. In my getMake, I basically return the make of the car, which I literally got from what the user input was, right? Model, I got from model. Color is something called color. And like we can obviously refactor it to whatever extent we want. And then setColor does the same thing, as in it sets the closure value variable to a new value and then sort of sets it here. And if you want, if you would try to get the color again, you would get the updated color. Here's an example for that. So in my factory module, if I call getMake, I get Corolla, Toyota, getModel is Corolla, getColor is white. But if I update the color to red, and if I call getColor again, it is red now. Right. So yeah, any questions around this? How it is happening, what is happening? Okay. I'll probably repeat it. So this is a module pattern. What I do here is basically return an object with the API, with sort of a function which calls my private members, right? I do not actually return the color white, color equals to white. I can very well do that. Like I can literally do a return of color here. But what will happen is I can then in my return, I can literally, oops, my battery is low, let me just plug it. The color. And as a module, you might not want that, right? To give the ability to change the color of the car just like that, right? Yeah, any questions around this so far?
Yeah, there is a question on a chat. What will happen if we call car factory module?
So it is implicitly called, if you see. So this, let me compare it against an iffy pattern. So there is an iffy pattern, right? I have not called it. It is immediately invoked because of this, right? So it gets called, right? And this is like it prints 42 here. So comparing that to this, this is the, so car factory module, you are not calling anything, right? Car factory module is just now a return of this iffy, which is basically this object literal, right? And from this, you are calling the getMake, getModel, whatever APIs that, whatever, like not the APIs per se, but whatever keys that you are exposing in this return. Does that answer your question? Yes, no. Okay,
yeah, that's in, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Fine, cool.
Sure. Yeah, so there is one more question which has been asked sometime back by Abhishek. What's the difference between the revealing module pattern and factory pattern?
So factory pattern is basically a creational design pattern, right? There are certain sort of creational pattern in general, right? So factory pattern is basically a design principle which kind of through which defines a set of principle which says that, hey, if you want to create a set of objects, this is how you might be able to do that, right? Revealing module pattern is a very specific pattern to JavaScript because of its inherent nature, how the JavaScript is designed. Right? Since there is, so the creational design, or the rather the factory design pattern sort of works around the object-oriented paradigm a bit better, because of the sort of the nature that say that constructs the objects from a class. But in JavaScript, since we do not have that, we do not have the private and public construct and anything else, we are kind of circling around that by using a revealing module pattern. That's why I gave an example of, hey, your logic, your business logic is still going to be in front end. You cannot use, let's say, Java for this because it is tied to your React app, and you will have to do this sort of thing using JavaScript. So how do you do that? Right? So you sort of need a factory pattern here in this particular example. But there's no clean way, clean way of doing that in JavaScript. You sort of have to get around that by using something. So that's where this module pattern and this revealing module pattern comes in.
Awesome. So one more question popping up related to this example, how we can add one more car here?
Very fair question. So to add one more car here, as you can see, there's a car factory module, which sort of that's where I was coming to actually, but that's a very fair question. So as you can see, it's a car factory module, which literally takes in a parameter called toyota and corolla. Let's say if you want to create a new one, in this particular example, this is a pretty contrived example, but in this example, you would have to create another, call it again with a, let's say, car two, or let's call it car factory, not car factory module, but rather car one, which is Toyota Corolla, and then this car two, which literally calls the same thing with Toyota Camry or something, and so on and so forth, which is not very proper, right? And that's sort of a drawback here, that we cannot do that, right? I'll probably try to answer this question in next few slides. But to give an answer, short answer, this is how we would do this right now. Till what we have seen so far. Another drawback to this is, let's say if you want to, change the behavior of get make, right? Let's say if you want to do, let's say you want to add your username to it additionally, like whatever make you give, you just add the username of this thing to whatever you have given, right? So for that to do, you would mostly have to change something on line 5, right? So to return the get make of this thing, which is sort of weird, right? So anything you do, you would have to make changes in the return of this function. There's no clean way of doing this. And this way, revealing module pattern comes in. It's sort of an extended version of module pattern with a bit cleaner way. The difference between this, the underlying difference between this is it still returns the same, still return a set of APIs to it, but now it returns to a pointer, which basically is to a private, or basically a private construct to it through a closure, right? So let's see here, right? This is a revealing module pattern, this particular slide. And it's the same thing. The only difference we have done is we have made car make model run something, and now you have get car make, set car make, something like that. All right. So you have get car make and set car make. What it basically does is get car make basically literally returns your car make, and set car make sets the variable of your car. Of your car module. This is again making use of closures, right? And similarly, car model get, and there's a getter and setter for the car model, for the car color as well. And now what you do in your return statement is basically return the pointer to the functions, right? So get car make, it's returns a pointer to the actual get car make, which is exposed now through a public, say, sort of interface, right? So if you do a car module dot set car make Toyota, right, you call this API, this method, which sets the car make variable to whatever variable that you have passed in. Similarly for all the other variables here, Does this make sense? Do you see what is the difference between a module pattern and a revealing module pattern? So this sort of makes it easy to change the APIs, right? If you want to now have, like, you know, as we said earlier, that get car make will now do something of the sort that you will return a user name along with the car, along with whatever the car make was. So you can literally add the change at one place, that it will add the username while before returning, it will add a username to what the car make was. And it's sort of a cleaner interface to what the actual module pattern is. Any question for this? Okay.
Yes, no, sir. I think we're good to.
All right.
So Abhishek is saying the problem is this is not extensible like classes.
Yeah, very fair question. And classes is what we'll talk about in the end. There's one inherent problem with the classes for this particular model, which we sort of talked about in the beginning. Let's see if any one of you can, I guess, answer that. It's not a problem per se, but how the JavaScript classes are designed. Okay, we'll get to that. Anyways, yeah, and fair. This is not very extensible. This is very fair to say that, hey, this, you like, if you want to do so, you, so there's no constructor as such per se. You are not instantiating this thing. If you want to add more APIs to it, that's not very well done, right? You still would have to return, and you would have still have to write that API, write that some sort of class method, and then you return in the object literal. Okay, but now let's talk about the, so this question came in as well, that this, if I still want to create a new car module, right? If I still want to create a new car, I would still have to repeat all of this all over again. So car one is, let's say, Toyota Corolla Red. Car two is now, let's say, again, all over the same thing with a Toyota Camry White something. To get around that, what it's pretty simple hack is basically we'll remove the iffy pattern from this thing, right? And we'll still use closures. And now what we have done here is, so now I'm calling this make model and color, right? I'm still using closures, and I'm still returning the object literal with all the APIs in it, right? Well, of course, not the set car make model, because that's what we are setting over in here. Now, I call C1 in the car factory Toyota Camry, and it sets make and model for me over here, right? And then if I want to get car, I'll just literally do a call of what was the car make, right? And it'll return me this thing. And yeah, and now we have the ability to create cars out dynamically, right? So now you are returning a function which returns an object. The object are the object literal is pointing to the private methods which it points to, and those basically returns the variable closures that this function is inheriting. So yeah, this answers the question that how do we make cars out of this module now? I hope this answers that question. Okay. Yeah. And now that's pretty much it. That's basically how the revealing module pattern works. As I said, there was not much to it. It was not very much complex other than just understanding the basic nature of how JavaScript works under the hood. And this is pretty much it. Now coming to the question of how the ES6 classes work, right? Any guesses what will go wrong if I use, it's not actually wrong, it's still okay to use it, but what could happen if I use classes. Any guesses here?
So like Manjot is saying in classes we don't have access specifier. Is this a problem?
No, access specifier we don't have in JavaScript in general. Like even here we did not have access specifier, but we sort of got around that by, you know, making a local variables and exposing them through APIs. But it is close, I guess. Any other stabs? Like we sort of talked about it in this talk, I mean, in this presentation.
Ankit is saying we could change the variables if we use classes.
Yeah, exactly. We can sort of change the constructor variables if we give classes. So let me show you an example, right, of this. So I have a class foo, and I have a constructor that says this dot, let's say foo, let's call it foo, right? This is it. And I have, get foo something. And it basically return this dot foo. And I have another thing, let's call it set foo. Return this dot, it'll take a variable, new. Right, and this is my class. So this is how I would have to call a class, right? And what will this is, what will give me is the constructor object, right? And I still have the foo.setFoo to, let's say, let's call getFoo first, right? And I have setFoo as well, and let's call it bar, right? And if I do call getFoo again, it gives me bar. But now I since have literally have the object constructor here, I can very well, you know, abuse it. And what was the object? Foo dot foo is equals to bars, right? And if I can call get foo, this is now bars. So think of it in this way, right? My module is shared among many, many apps, right? And if any one of the app does this, this, it is now changed across all the objects, right? And that's the basic kind of, you know, I won't say problem, but it's sort of this thing that this can be abused in general. And that's again because I can access, I can, like, you know, go up the prototype chain and change this as well. Even if I use this, right? Even if I use any of this thing, I can still sort of abuse that by going up to its prototype chain. This is sort of a gotcha, you can say. But yeah, I guess this was the point that I was coming to. But it is still recommended to use class because if you can at least, like, you know, safeguard this thing in your project, in your across project, if you use some sort of, like, you know, TypeScript or flow. But since that still boils down to JavaScript in runtime, your code, the code in the browser is still running the runtime JavaScript. And that is still possible to, that still can be abused through. But since that is like, we can have an entirely separate conversation around that. Since that is like separated by its own processors, browser, blah blah blah, that's sort of prevented.
Yeah. So Ankit has a point here, saying the workaround could be specifically return object instead of this being returned implicitly in case of classes.
So I did not get that. Can you how classes
What?
how sorry objects how like constructor returns your object, and if you return object, let's say foo object is object which has sort of this, I guess, right? I would still get this object, right? What? Okay, redeclaration. So let me call this new foo. Cool. So new foo is equals to new foo, right? I'd still get that object, and I can still change that, right? So the basic nature of classes is that it returns the constructor in my once I do the new instantiation, right? It will return me whatever is in the constructor, and that's what we were discussing when we were, you know, doing this sort of thing dot prototype. It returns me the string constructor, and if I go slightly above one more chain, it returns me an object constructor, and the top is then it is obviously null. So null, yeah. Yeah, I guess that was all from my side. Thank you. Any further questions? Anything that did not make sense you would want to repeat?
Yeah, so question time, guys. So if anybody has any questions, comments, they can make here. So we'll just wait for 2 more minutes and for any questions, and then we'll wind up. So before that, so our next meetup, which is coming on 21st of March. So it will be a boot camp on web performance, which will be taken, which will be conducted by Sunny Puri with us. So we'll be doing that this time Sunday. So first time we're doing on Sunday as a meetup. So it will be on Sunday because of some other meetups which is happening on same time. We thought Sunday will be the better to avoid those clashes. So web performance bootcamp, it will be pretty interesting topic because there will be very large topics which we are planning to cover, a very good range of topic, I'll say, on web performance. And Sunny Puri, I think most of you might be know, he has already spoken multiple times on our JavaScript meetup conference, and he has his own conference called DevCode also. I think most of you might be aware of it. So I am really looking forward to the session. So if you're interested, you can RSVP on that meetup. I'm just pasting that link on our chat. Yeah. So, and if you have any question for Varun, yeah, you can ask. We have still 1 more minute to go. Varun, it was really a wonderful session. A lot more insight. I really loved your talk.
Thank you.
Okay, cool. So I don't see any questions flowing. So thank you all for your time. Thank you, Varun, for your time and effort. I know, be it a small talk or large, it takes a lot of preparation time behind the scene. So thank you, Akshay, who was our first speaker. Thank you, Varun. And thank you all who joined us on Saturday morning. So have a good day. Have a good weekend. Bye-bye. See you on our next meetup.
Thank you. Bye.